Morning and good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for joining us today for our webinar, Beamforming in Software Defined Radio. Please feel free to use the Q&A box on the right to ask a question at any time. We will be featuring two presenters today, Tudor Davies, the Director of Technology at Spectrum, and Cyrus C., Manager of Business Development. Tudor joined Spectrum in 1998 and has successfully led teams to develop and deliver products that met complex customer requirements. In this role, he defines the architecture of Spectrum's future products and projects. Tudor holds a master's degree in electrical engineering from the Royal Military College of Canada and served for 20 years in the Canadian Navy as a combat systems engineer. Cyrus C. has more than 10 years of experience here at Spectrum in a variety of different roles, including applications engineering, technical marketing, and business development. Cyrus received his Bachelor of Applied Science degree from Simon Fraser University in Burnaby, British Columbia. Now we will begin our presentation, and again, a reminder that at any time, you can ask a question by using the Q&A panel on the right. I pass it over to you, Tudor.
Thank you. First, I'd like to go through the agenda for the next hour. We'll start off with an introduction, and then some beamforming concepts, developing some of the antenna theory required. And then I'll talk about beamforming in software-defined radio, such as a typical beamforming system and some of the key requirements that those systems need to have in order to implement beamforming. And then I'll hand it over to Cyrus, and he'll walk through a software-defined radio beamforming implementation, including mapping requirements onto an actual platform and some implementation examples. We'll then have some conclusions, and we'll have some time at the end for questions and answers. So let's start off with what is beamforming? We define it as a technique using an array of multiple sensor or emitter elements to increase the response in a particular direction and minimize the response in other directions. The sensor or emitter elements may be antennas or acoustic transducers like microphones and hydrophones. As an old Navy guy who did sonars, I want to mention that sonar has been using digital beamforming for decades. You remember in the Hunt for Red October, Jonesy is using a sonar to sense submarines with digital processing. People have also been using Spectrum's products to do beamforming in radio for over a decade, and it's becoming more cost-effective as digital electronics advance. I'd like to just address some of the differences between transmitters and receivers in beamforming, because it applies to both. First line, in a transmitter you have multiple transmit sources, in a receiver you have multiple receiving elements. In a transmitter you want to maximize the signal output towards the desired direction. In a receiver, you want to maximize the sensitivity towards signals received from a particular direction. And you also want to minimize, in a transmitter, minimize the signal output power to an undesired direction. And in a receiver, you want to minimize the strength of signals received from an undesired direction. So why would you want to do beamforming? First is to improve the response to the desired signals. You can also reject interfering signals by reducing the response in the direction of the interferer, such as a jammer. You can electronically steer the antenna beam towards a target rapidly without moving the antenna. With this, you get the added benefit of reducing the amount of moving parts in the antenna system. You can increase wireless network capacity by enabling frequency reuse in different sectors near a base station. This can help you deal with the increasing signal density in wireless communications that we see nowadays. You can also do direction finding to determine the direction of signal sources. And you can reduce the size and cost in a lot of cases by replacing a large directional antenna with an array of smaller non-directional antennas, which can be lower cost. I'd like to just draw some distinctions about beamforming and direction finding. So direction finding uses multiple antenna elements to measure the angle of arrival of a signal. And that can be done by using the phase differences between the different elements, or it can be done even by using amplitude using directional antennas. Beamforming, on the other hand, uses multiple antenna elements to cause an increased response in a desired direction or reduced response in another direction. Now, you can use a beamformer with multiple beams to determine the angle of arrival of a signal, so beamformers can be used in direction finding applications. And it's actually one of the good ways to do direction finding. So beamforming in radio depends on an array of antennas as its interface to the real world. And antenna arrays are everywhere. Here are just a few examples. And I won't go through all of them, but at the top left, you can see some panel antennas that are used in commercial wireless communications. The little panel at the top left consists of a printed circuit board with multiple patch elements on it. And the panel antenna acts as a fixed direction array. And just to the right of that, you see a cellular base station which has several of these panel antennas on it, and they're oriented towards three different sectors. When you want to steer the direction of transmission or reception, you have to be able to vary the delay between antenna elements. And the two other ones of interest are at the bottom left and the bottom right. These two arrays are active electronically steered phased array radars. They're used by the U.S. Navy and the U.S. Air Force. On the bottom left, the AN-SPY-1, or SPY-1 radar, has over 1,000 elements and can track multiple targets with the accuracy of a fire control radar while simultaneously serving as the ship's air search and surface search radar. On the bottom right, you see the FPS-85 radar, which is a sky search radar used by the U.S. Air Force to detect ballistic missiles. The phased array lets you have the huge radar antenna that can scan without moving the antenna. You wouldn't want to have to move that antenna. Compare the size of that radar antenna with the helicopter pad on the top of the picture. I'll skip some of the other pictures, but they show various types. All of those antennas are arrays. So I'd like to cover some beamforming concepts. We'll need to cover some antenna theory to get started. Now, Stephen Hawking once said that with each equation you put up, you lose half your audience, so I'll try to keep the equations to a minimum. First concept is the beam pattern. The whole purpose of a beamformer is to achieve response that depends on direction, or to achieve a desired beam pattern for the antenna array. It's represented here as a polar plot of the system's response as a function of the angle of arrival. In this case, we're assuming that this is a receiving array for the moment. This is also called the radiation pattern or far field response. I'll use those terms interchangeably. You can see at the top, pointing upwards, the main beam is where the response is the highest, the maximum. To the right and left of that are nulls, or points of minimum response. And then you also have side lobes on the sides. This is a simple plot. In reality, you're going to have multiple side lobes, and they go all the way around the back of the array. Next concept is called reciprocity. Most antennas and arrays have this property where they behave the same way whether they're in transmit or receive modes. The electronic equipment doesn't, but the antenna array is symmetrical that way. Now, in this webinar, some concepts are easier to illustrate in transmit mode and others are easier to illustrate in receive. So in our examples, we'll use both, whichever is more convenient. You can assume that the same properties apply in both transmit and receive cases. There are some exceptions to reciprocity where it doesn't apply, such as in nonlinear magnetic materials with hysteresis, but in most cases you can make use of this reciprocity property. So I'd like to talk about the far field. In most cases you can make simplifying assumptions when you're in the far field. So what is the far field? When an emitter is putting out electromagnetic waves, they expand spherically as they propagate. When you get far enough away, in the picture moving further to the right, the spherical wavefront grows big enough that you can assume that it's flat, just as you can assume that the Earth is flat in your local area for many things. We'll rely on this for some of our examples. You can generally assume that you're in the far field when you're 10 times further away than the target, and that's usually more than 10 wavelengths away. Several other simplifications also rely on the far field assumption. And it's analogous to, say, a camera focused on infinity. When you're target is 100 meters away or 100 miles away, you're still focused at infinity. Some exceptions to this, there is a technique called focused array processing, which does not make this assumption. It actually assumes a spherical wavefront, and this can make use of the non-flat wavefront to estimate the distance from an emitter. I'd like to talk about antenna gain. The gain of an antenna or an array is a key figure of merit for the system. Gain is related to directivity. It's the ratio of the response in the desired direction, or the height of the main lobe, to that of an ideal isotropic radiator. So it's expressed in dBi, or decibels, relative to an isotropic antenna, which radiates equally in all directions. And it's a 10 log rule, as it's a power ratio. So 10 log of that ratio is the gain in dBi. So the radiation pattern picture on the top right, that's a polar plot. The gain is the ratio of the height of the main lobe versus the average of power over all of space in a complete spherical average. The predicted gain of an array or an aperture increases as the ratio of the aperture or area to the wavelength. And it's given by that equation on the right. That's easy to calculate for something like a dish where you can say the area, but there's a similar relationship for linear arrays. The bigger antenna compared to the wavelength has the higher gain. Now I'd like to talk about a simple antenna, the half-wave dipole. This is commonly used in many applications. Lots of amateur radio operators use these, and they're used as basic elements all over the place. So the electromagnetic field strength at any point in space is due to the sum of the field contributions from all parts of the transmitting antenna. This one's easy to talk about for transmit. The field contributions depend on the current at each point along the antenna wire. And that average is, for each point in space, is an integral along the length of the wire. The antenna has a current distribution along its length that's shown on the left. For a half-wave dipole, it's zero at the ends because there's an open circuit there, and it's maximum at the center where the cable field feed comes in. This is true for a half-wave dipole, but it differs for different antenna lengths relative to the wavelength. So as you change the frequency, the current distribution changes and the far field pattern changes as well. The far field radiation pattern is shown in the center picture, and the 3D version of it is shown on the right, that donut. An interesting relationship is that the far field radiation pattern is the Fourier transform of the current distribution on the transmitting antenna. This is a useful relationship when you're trying to figure out what your radiation pattern is going to be. Now, for an ideal half-wave dipole, the gain is 2.15 dBs. Ideal means it's perfectly efficient. In reality, there are some losses, and that can even amount to a couple of dBs in some cases. So the gain of this antenna is the relationship of the size of that donut compared to the spherical pattern that would come out from an isotropic radiator. So you have gain because you're not sending signals straight up and straight down. So another common type of antenna that we see everywhere is a dish or a parabolic reflector antenna. The dish antenna actually transmits a flat circular wavefront that results from signals from the focus bouncing off the parabolic reflector and coming out straight. This three wavelength diameter dish in the picture shows quite a narrow beam, which represents high gain. Many dish antennae are much larger than three wavelengths in diameter, and the gain increases with the square of the ratio of diameter to wavelength. A gain of 30 dBs is not unusual. I saw an ad for a backyard C-band TV dish with a gain of 38 dBs, and you could buy it for like $100. That was a 1.8 meter dish. You can get a similar gain with a smaller dish at higher frequencies. Ku band, for example, lots of TV antennas have similar gains, but they operate at 12 gigahertz, so you can use a smaller antenna to get a similar gain. The world's biggest dish, the Arecibo Radio Telescope in Puerto Rico, has a gain of 70 dBi at 2.38 gigahertz, and that's the picture at the bottom. If you saw one of the James Bond movies, they had a fight scene on that antenna. With a high gain, the dish antenna is very popular where you want to have a narrow beam width, such as satellite communications or tracking radars. There are some other cases where having a very wide, a very narrow beam is not as useful. You want to have a larger coverage. So dishes and phased arrays. Many military radars use phased arrays to replace the dish. On the left, you can see an antenna, a dish antenna used on an F-117 fighter plane. And on the right, the phased array antenna, which is used in the nose of an F-15. They have a similar aperture, but the phased array is lighter, although it has the same physical size almost. The phased array also gives you the ability to steer the direction without moving the antenna. Next concept I'd like to talk about is spatial sampling. So an array approximates the emissions of many parts of the antenna. We've mentioned that the beam pattern depends on the current distribution on the antenna. The array approximates the emissions on many parts of the antenna by using small antennas to produce samples at various points along the equivalent antenna. This is like sampling in the time domain, like the sinusoid on the right side of the picture of the slide, and the pixels in the arrow cursor. Many concepts are equivalent to time sampling as well. At the bottom of the slide, you see the current distribution on the half-wave dipole, and on the right, it's approximated by the currents in the various array elements. Now, for a simple antenna, the current distribution is dictated by the physical structure of the antenna, like a half-wave dipole. If you change the frequency, it's no longer a half-wave dipole, and the current distribution changes. A key advantage of the array is that we can choose the current in each antenna element as we see fit, including its phase and amplitude. This gives us more flexibility in the beam patterns that we can achieve. So the most basic array has two elements. So let's just look at that and expand a little bit. We assume for now that a top view, we're looking down on an array of two antennas, and let's assume they're dipoles. The basic elements are the two circles, red and blue. We have a flat wavefront, the green line, arriving from the top of the picture, which we'll call north. It arrives at both antenna elements at the same time, and the sinusoids in the red box are in phase. We pass them through an adder, and they interfere constructively, so they get a stronger sinusoid in the blue box on the right. A key feature is that the noise is not coherent in the two antenna elements. We rely on that assumption. So it does not add constructively, and it does not get amplified by the array. Now let's look at this with different angles of arrival. I hope you can see the animation in this slide. When the angle of arrival is not from the north, it's called broadside, or it, when it is from the north, it's called broadside to the array. When it's not from the north, we'll call it off-axis. As the angle of arrival comes from other directions than north, the sinusoids move around in phase in the red box, and you can see the resulting sinusoid on the right in the blue box. They don't add constructively, so it gets weaker when you're off-axis of the array. So in this way, the array is configured to maximize the response in the broadside direction, which is north. Now let's move to an array with some delay added. We're just taking the same array and we're putting a delay line in one of the antennas. We'll call that the red antenna. And you see in the red box at the left that the off-axis signal is arriving with the two sinusoids out of phase. We apply a delay to the red line, but only to the red line. And then in the green box, the two sinusoids add in phase. And so those, when you add them together, you have a strong signal. So you have to choose your delay carefully so that the delta T, the difference in time, matches the delta T in the path difference. And that's given by the equation just above the blue antenna. Let's generalize to a beamformer, a generic beamformer, where we introduce delays on all of the antenna lines to make the beamformer have a strong response in a desired direction. And the delay lines are delays that we can choose to suit. For a constant beam direction, you can do it with something as simple as different lengths of cables to the antennas. This is common for radio broadcasts where you just want to direct your signal power towards your target market. There's been an AM radio broadcaster halfway between New York and Philadelphia that's been doing that since the 30s. And they use fixed beams towards New York and Philadelphia. When you want to be able to vary your signal direction, you have to have variable delays. And this historically has been done with analog phase shifters, as in the next example. So this diagram illustrates a transmitting array with 8 elements. The signal on to the rightmost element gets the leading phase, so it has the gets transmit first, and successive phase delays are applied as you move further to the left. So the circles represent the expanding wavefronts from the successive elements. The red wavefront is from the rightmost element with the leading phase, so it has had the longest time to propagate, so it's the biggest wavefront. The other elements lag, so the wavefronts are smaller. And that results in where they constructively interfere in space is the blue line that you see coming from the bottom left to the top right. One important thing to note in the diagram is the equation on the right side in the box. This gives you the required phase difference, or delta phi, between the elements on a linear array to form a beam in the direction of theta from broadside. In this diagram, the beamform is built using analog phase shifters applied to each element. We're now looking at animation. Hopefully you can see this animation. It's an animated GIF. This antenna array has 6 elements, and they are also arranged with a phase shifted. Now this one's the leading phase is on the right, and it is delayed as you move. Sorry, leading phase is on the left, and delayed as you move on to the right. So the beams are in the opposite direction. One of the things you can see in this array is that because it's a linear array, it's symmetrical. The north and the south sides have a similar pattern. If you want to have a pattern that only transmits in one direction, you can use an end-fire type array rather than broadside, or you can have a two-dimensional array. So looking back at the generic beamformer, we're going to use phase delays. In RF systems, it's easier to introduce phase delays than time delays. The phase shift can be applied by a complex multiplication by a weight, as we call it, for each antenna element. The weight is a complex number which represents amplitude and phase. The complex multiplication is easily done in the digital time domain, or in the digital frequency domain as well. There's one limitation to this. A constant time delay represents different phase delays at different frequencies. So the ideal phase delay for a given beam pattern is different for different frequencies. You can get away with this over a certain frequency range, but if you tune over a wide range, you may have to adjust your weights to account for the frequency difference. This, of course, is easy to do in a digital beamformer. On the other hand, one advantage of using phase is that you can make small adjustments in the delay, which may be a small fraction of the sample period in a digital system. So it's easier than delaying the sampled time domain. Life is full of trade-offs. So some sample beam patterns for arrays. This slide shows the beam patterns for a few different configurations of 2-element and 4-element arrays. You can see some of the differences. I won't go through them all, but the beam patterns at the bottom, where you have more elements, they give a narrower beam width, and the narrow beam width is equated to more gain and more rejection of noise and interference from other directions. Hence, a system requirement for narrow beam width often drives the number of elements. This, of course, also drives the size and cost of the array and the beamformer. There's some analogies between the spatial domain and the frequency domain. The beamformer is a spatial filter. Its response depends on the angle of arrival rather than a response depending on frequency. There is a Nyquist criterion in the spatial case as well. For an array that's intended to cover beams in any direction, or all look angles as we call them, the elements must be no more than half wavelength apart. For limited look angles, close to broadside for example, the maximum spacing can be higher, given by this equation. If you violate the spatial Nyquist criterion, you can get spatial aliasing or grating lobes, a side lobe that can be as high as the main lobe. Another concept is near field, far field, and the Fourier transform. A far field radiation pattern of a linear antenna is the Fourier transform as of the current distribution along the antenna, as we mentioned with the half-wave dipole. Far field radiation pattern of an array is the Fourier transform of the current in the individual array elements. For a 2D array, a 2D Fourier transform also can give you this. Time domain samples are analogous to points along the array in the near field, and frequency domain spectrum is analogous to the far field radiation pattern. So a lot of the properties apply, and you can use that to understand how the far field is going to look. Let's look at some system performance requirements and what you need to do in your system in order to achieve them. So a specification might say you have to tune over a certain frequency range. That, of course, drives some of the electronic elements, but it also drives your array design. You need to have array spacing to account for the highest frequency. And to account for everything, you have to be spaced no more than lambda by 2. You also have to size for the lowest frequency, so your array has to be big enough in order to account for, to have enough directionality at the lowest frequency. And this often, if you have to have enough, you have to have your elements close enough together for the highest frequency and a big enough array for the lowest frequency, that drives more elements. And of course, that means more electronics to process all those elements. And this can drive your cost. There are techniques to reduce the array. You may perhaps use a sparse array where some of the array is has the elements close enough together for the highest frequency, but the elements are spaced out, so it's not a completely uniform array. You may have them further apart to account for the lowest frequency to get the big array. Second one, instantaneous bandwidth. This primarily drives the processing in the platform that contains the beamformer, more so than the array design itself. The platform, they are processing bandwidth have to be high enough with sampling rates and interconnect data rates high enough to handle the bandwidth. Beamwidth, or DF accuracy, they're similar. They're driven by the array size and the number of elements, and that, of course, drives the number of elements in the electronics and cost. Sensitivity. One thing that I would like to note for an array, each low-gain antenna element needs to, if you're in a receiving array, it needs to have a more sensitive receiver than when you have one high-gain antenna, because each antenna is receiving a weaker signal than if you had something like a dish. And so that drives the electronics to have low noise amplifiers and similar things like that to get the sensitivity without having too much noise in the electronics. The speed of direction change, if you want to be able to switch directions of an array, you need to be able to quickly switch the phase shifts or the weights in your beamformer. And you need the ability to reload weights. This is where a digital beamformer has a key advantage. And the probability of detection, if you're in a receiver and you want to be able to look at beams in many directions all at the same time so that you don't miss a signal on to the northeast when you're looking to the northwest, you can have to have a beamformer that's capable of processing beams, multiple beams at the same time. This, of course, causes additional processing load and interconnect data rates, so you need to have a system that's capable of handling that. We'll now look at some of the figures of merit. Well, that is some of the figures of merit for the beamforming system. I'd now like to talk about beamforming in software-defined radio and how they can be used, how software-defined radio platforms can be used to implement beamformers. So first, I'll give you a definition. The current industry standard definition for a software-defined radio is a radio in which some or all of the physical layer functions are software-defined. And that's from the Wireless Innovation Forum, formerly called the SDR Forum, which is the industry forum for software-defined radio. I'd like to expand on this definition with some characteristics of software-defined radios. This was used by the U.S. Joint Tactical Radio System Program about a decade ago. A software-defined radio has these characteristics. An analog RF front end converts RF to IF, or vice versa, in transmit. Signals are digitized at IF, or they can be digitized at baseband INQ. All processing from IF down is performed on programmable processing elements. These processing elements may be DSPs, general purpose processors, or FPGAs, field programmable gate arrays. A few other radio variants by this JTRS definition. If the digitization is performed at RF, like right at the antenna, you can call it a software radio. So the difference between a software-defined radio and a software radio has no analog front end. And that's the difference there. The definition over the last few years, the terms have been used interchangeably, but I say a software radio has no analog front end. Also, if processing is performed on a special purpose ASIC, then it's the digital radio rather than a software-defined radio. Now, we'll consider a software-defined radio using these characteristics. Let's look at a difference between a couple of beamformers in a similar application, a satellite for subscribers on the ground. So the first one is a fixed function beamformer. This one is on the Globalstar satellite. It's an example of a fixed function beamformer where the subscriber uplink and downlink are done by these antenna arrays on the satellite. I won't go through the rest of them, but the slides will be available, but these are some of the characteristics. The beamformer is actually on the satellite, and it is a fixed function. It projects 16 fixed beams on the ground as the satellite passes overhead. It's a low Earth orbit satellite, but it still has an orbital altitude of 1,400 kilometers, and the array needs to be strong enough that you can get a signal to that handheld on the ground. Now, some communication satellite systems use reconfigurable software-defined beamformers. This is popular for the subscriber links, where you want to be able to change your links with your coverage as the subscriber demand changes. You can allocate coverage based on subscriber service demand because this satellite here has a 15-year life, and your subscriber demand may change in different geographical areas over the life of the satellite. This example is Boeing's SkyTerra 1 satellite, which uses a Viasat ground-based beamformer. I won't go through the rest of the details, but you can see the slides afterwards. We'll now look at a software-defined radio-based digital beamformer. So expanding on the diagram we had before, this block diagram shows a receive beamformer, which you can build with a software-defined radio platform, provided that the platform has certain key elements. So going through the block diagram, for each antenna element, there's an RF translator, which in this case is a tuner. It accepts an RF signal and mixes it with a local oscillator and results in an intermediate frequency, or IF, such as, say, 70 or 140 megahertz. These are popular. The IF is bandpass filtered to eliminate images and noise out of the band. The IF then goes to an analog to digital converter for each element. The digitized samples are sent to a digital down converter, which selects a frequency within the IF band and down converts it to baseband or 0 hertz. The baseband samples are complex numbers with in-phase and quadrature components, or INQ. These are the real and imaginary parts for each sample. In a software-defined radio, the DDC is typically done in an FPGA, a field programmable gate array. This gives lots of flexibility in how it's implemented. Next, the weighting and summation stages are done. These can be done in the FPGA or elsewhere in the system. We have the flexibility to apply weights digitally and rapidly change them as desired. In this four-element beamform, you can use it for a four-element linear array or a square array, whatever type of configuration you want to do. Similarly, larger beamformers with more elements can be in 2D or even 3D arrays. So expanding on this one, some of the key requirements that the beamformer hardware has to have. First of all, your SDR platform must have phase coherency between the elements. Beamforming relies on using the phase between elements in order to achieve its objectives, so you have to have a few things to ensure that. First of all, the RF translators or tuners must have a common local oscillator. Next, the ADCs have to share a common sampling clock, so their samples are in phase, and then you must be able to align the samples so that you know which sample is number one from the different ADCs. It's also desirable to have a calibration capability to account for things like cable links and delays in various parts of the system. Next, the interprocessor links have to be able to handle the bandwidth of the signals. The bandwidth dictates the minimum sampling rate that you can use, and your system has to be able to handle the data rate that is dictated by the sampling rate. The processing elements have to be able to handle the processing load, of course. The multiply and summation stages at the bottom of the slide are replicated for each beam. So the more beams you have, the more multipliers and adders that you're going to need. Fortunately, these don't consume that much in the way of FPGA resources. The majority in this case is used up in the digital down converters. And finally, for a high probability detection, you may have to put a bunch of those beamformers in parallel to be able to look in multiple directions at the same time if you're in, say, a signal intelligence system where you want to simultaneously look in all directions. I'd like to talk a little about the selection of weights. So the weights are those numbers, those complex numbers that we multiply by the samples in each array element. We talked about the far-field radiation pattern being the Fourier transform of the current distribution. Remember that before you do an FFT, you want to be able to apply a window function to the time domain samples to control things like side lobes in the frequency domain. In the spatial domain, an SDR lets you adjust the weights for each antenna element in both amplitude and phase. The phase generally determines the direction of the main lobe, and we can apply a window function like in the time domain, but we apply it to the amplitude of the various elements. This is also called shading, where we typically reduce the amplitude of the outer elements. You can choose your amplitude distribution window or window function to tailor to the beam pattern. Two pictures show the resultant beam pattern for two different amplitude distributions for the same array. The picture on the left shows a Taylor window function, and the one on the right shows a Blackman window function. You can see that the Taylor one on the left has a narrower beam, but the side lobes are higher. You have the side lobes are only about 20 dBs down. The Blackman one on the right has a wider beam, about 20 degrees versus 10, but you get almost 30 dBs of difference between the side lobes and the main lobe. So this is one of the advantages in an SDR, is that you can quickly change those to the environment that you're working in. I'd now like to talk about adaptive beamforming, which is about adjusting the weights to suit the environment. Adaptive beamforming is one type of MIMO, multiple in, multiple out processing, and it's about optimization for a desired result. A couple of examples are beam steering and null steering. Beam steering, where you adjust the main beam towards your target, which may move slightly from where your original beam was pointed, and null steering, you may want to minimize response toward an interferer or a jammer, and you can adapt to changes in, say, the location of the interfering signal while maintaining response toward the desired signal. So you can place a null in the direction of the interferer or jammer. So this example shows a technique for beamforming, and these techniques generally involve optimizing for a particular parameter, such as a cost function. In this example, it was done by an experiment by Georgia Tech for NASA. They optimized a beamformer for communicating with a low Earth orbit satellite in an urban environment with lots of multipath interference from reflections off buildings and so on. The satellite provided a reference signal, and the system adjusted weights 4,000 times per second to match a training sequence or an expected beamformer output to the known reference signal. So doing something like this helps you adjust for the rapidly changing position of the low Earth orbit satellite, which moves across the sky in maybe about 10 minutes. So your multipath environment changes rapidly. There are other algorithms for adaptation, but it's complex stuff, and I won't go into that. It's actually an area popular for research now, and PhDs are earned on this type of work all the time. So if you want to go get your PhD, there's something you can work on. And please send me your results. I'd now like to turn over to Cyrus to describe a practical implementation of a software-defined radio implementation of beamforming.
Thank you, Tudor. We shall now present an example implementation of a four-element beamformer which uses an integrated COTS SDR platform that is currently available from Spectrum. This platform is called the SDR 2010 and is a system based on a powerful Intel Xeon or Core i5, i7 server class computer. It can be supplied in a rack mount or desktop tower, which is well suited for development or deployment in ground benign environments. This integrated SDR platform consists of multiple PCI Express carrier boards that host analog I/O XMC processing modules, each with powerful Xilinx Vertex 5 FPGAs. The SDR 2010 hardware subsystem is configured with the carrier boards and modules already installed, integrated, and fully tested. Let's look at its main components in more detail. Our example implementation consists of a combination of analog IF processing modules, the XMC 1131 or XMC 2131. The XMC 1131 is intended for a received beamformer and has two ADCs capable of sampling at up to 250 megasamples per second at 14-bit resolution, coupled with a Xilinx Vertex 5 FX130T FPGA. The XMC 2131 is intended for a transmit beamformer and has two DACs, or DDAs, which sample at 300 megasamples per second, also at 14 bits and coupled to a Vertex 5 FPGA. These mezzanine modules are installed on a full-length PCIe carrier board called a Pro2910, which plugs into a standard PCI Express slot on the host PC or server. Each Pro2910 can host up to two XMC modules. The carrier and module architecture of this platform allow you to easily add the required number of analog ADC and DAC inputs to match the number of array elements. We'll now take a closer look at how a four-element receive beamformer is implemented using these modules. Our example implementation assumes the use of an external tunable RF front end to downconvert to an IF, such as 70 MHz. There are two XMC 1131s mounted onto one Pro2910 to provide a total of four ADC inputs. The required phase coherency is guaranteed by the use of a common sample clock, as well as a sync signal shown in red that is implemented using the general purpose I/O lines that are available on the front panel of the XMC 1131. The ADCs are coupled to a Xilinx Vertex 5 FX130T for each XMC module. The FX130T offers a large mix of DSP and memory resources. If more resources are needed, a larger FPGA device also is supported as a build option. The Pro2910 carrier board connects to the host PC via a Gen 2 PCIe X8 link and an onboard fabric interface which routes data to and from the XMC modules and the host PC. The Xilinx Xeon multi-core general purpose processor is used for primarily downstream processing and to also act as a main system controller. Now let's take a close look at how the key pieces of a beamforming system are mapped onto this hardware platform, along with a few other variations that are possible. For the purposes of this example, each of the four elements requires an IF bandwidth of 40 MHz, which must be brought all the way down to baseband. Each input is digitized or sampled phase coherently. A digital down converter is used to tune to the desired frequency. This DDC must be sufficient to handle the required baseband sampling rate for that bandwidth. The output of the DDC is complex INQ baseband, which is then combined with the required weight through a complex multiply operation. By adjusting the weights via software control from the host, you can rapidly adapt or switch beams. The output of the DDC and the complex multiplier should be 50 megasamples per second INQ to cover the necessary 40 megahertz, which translates to 200 megabytes per second, assuming 4 bytes per INQ sample. In this scenario, the final summation of each element occurs at the GPP. Output from each weighted input goes directly from each XMC module at 200 megabytes per second, for a total aggregate bandwidth of 800 megabytes per second to the host GPP. The PCI interface between the Pro2910 carrier and the host PCI PC is an X8 link capable of up to 2 gigabyte per second throughput. This is adequate to handle the data from four channels. However, the limiting factor becomes the GPP, which will be heavily swamped by the data, leaving less cycles on the GPP for any useful processing algorithms. Your options are then to either further limit the down-converted bandwidth of the signal in the FPGA we used another approach to reduce the total data rate to the host PC. Let's look at an alternative scenario where you can do this by taking advantage of the programmable nature of the FPGA and high-speed data paths on the board. In this scenario, you will notice that the summation of the elements is done in stages, where the sum of each pair of elements is done in the FPGA, and the final summation from both pairs is done at the GPP. Consequently, the communications load from the FPGAs to the GPP is reduced by half, from a total of 800 megabytes per second to a total of 400 megabytes per second. The trade-off is more processing must be done in the FPGA. However, the FX130T part has sufficient resources to handle this, and we will present a slide later on which presents some resource utilization numbers. In this final scenario, the bandwidth to the GPP can be further reduced by summing the first pair of weighted outputs and then moving that data to the FPGA on the adjacent XMC module to be summed within that FPGA. This can be supported by a change in the FPGA code and changing the routing of the data to use the direct high-speed links that are available between the two XMC sites on the carrier board. The use of this link does not require any host intervention or use of the onboard PCI links on the host PC. The resulting data bandwidth to the GPP is a single 200 megabyte per second data stream. From these three simple scenarios, you can see the same hardware platform and its components configured in a variety of ways to optimize and make use of the processing resources available. The following table shows the resource usage on the Vertex 5 FX130T FPGA to implement the two digital down converters, the complex multiplication for weights, and summation stage. Our DDC implementation uses a polyphase filter approach, which minimizes the number of slices used. We also reuse multipliers because we can run the multiplier add stage faster at 200 megahertz compared to the 50 megahertz clock. The result is that we can carry out the required 8 multiplication operations with just 2 multiplier resources in the FPGA. As you will notice from the figures, the bulk of the processing is in the digital down conversion. The resources needed to apply the complex weights are minimal, which means one could readily implement multiple complex multiply and add stages in the same FPGA, which is equivalent to having multiple beamformers. The three scenarios shown help to underscore the importance of the system software that is supplied with the software-defined radio platform hardware. The supporting software and FPGA infrastructure and tools must allow the developer to easily and rapidly take advantage of the reconfigurable nature of the hardware. An example of this might be to modify and rebuild the application and reconfigure the routing of data between the modules, as you have seen earlier. This starts by providing the developer with an easy-to-use and understand hardware abstraction layer, or HAL, that enables flexible interprocessor communications without having to understand the underlying data transfer mechanisms, such as PCI Express. Secondly, system data flow examples and FPGA application reference designs help to accelerate development by providing a working example data flow and allowing you to drop in your application code. Support for model-based design tools such as MATLAB and Simulink also allow developers who are used to working with a model or GUI-based environment to rapidly develop their application with minimal or no knowledge of FPGA programming or RTL language. Spectrum's QuickCom software and FPGA development kit offers all of the above and is offered on Spectrum's SDR platforms, including the SDR 2010, which you have seen. The following slides show some different configurations that can be built using the same SDR hardware. We have demonstrated that greater beam width, higher gain, and better accuracy for beamforming can be realized by using more intelligent elements or increasing the number of array elements. By taking advantage of the modular and scalable nature of the SDR 2010 hardware, we can implement an 8-element beamformer system by adding 2 more additional XMC 1131 modules, which are mounted to a second Pro 2910 carrier board. This is possible since the PC server can host multiple PCIe processing cards. In order to maintain phase coherency, a common reference clock is used along with daisy chain sampling sync line that connects the 4 XMC cards. The Pro 2910 carrier card also has 2 external high-speed data ports that can be used to connect more than one carrier board together via cable. This unique feature allows FPGAs of multiple carriers and XMC modules to communicate directly with each other without host PC intervention, and reducing the processing load on the GPP. The system software provided with the platform, specifically the QuickCon hardware and abstraction layer, make it easy to configure the data flows between the FPGAs across different Pro2910 cards. So far, we have been talking about a receiving beamform application, and here we illustrated the fact that a transmitter beamformer could also be configured using the XMC2131 DAC module. The remaining hardware can remain the same, and this configuration is shown here for reference. Our last and final variation of a beamformer is one which utilizes a frequency domain versus a time domain approach. In using a frequency domain approach, the FPGA is used to do an FFT, or fast Fourier transform, at high sampling rate to extract the phase and amplitude information for each bin or frequency of interest. The advantages of this approach is that you can apply weights that are frequency dependent, where the phase is optimized to the array at that particular frequency. For a direction finder application, you can calculate the angle of arrival for many different frequencies in parallel. This approach is only made possible by the use of an FPGA, since it is capable of processing the digitized stream from each element at the sample rate. As we draw this webinar to a conclusion, it is worth summarizing what we have covered. We have outlined the basic concepts of beamforming and direction finding and how the typical system requirements impact the hardware platform requirements. We presented an example implementation of an SDR platform, Spectrum's SDR2010, and illustrated how the same SDR platform hardware could be configured to meet different scenarios. The key benefits of using a software-defined radio platform such as the SDR2010 include its suitability for adaptive beamforming, the fact that it scales well to support multi-element antenna arrays, it can be easily upgraded to add additional capability or performance enhancements without hardware changes, and finally, the ability to reuse the platform and application code base for multiple missions or projects. We invite you to contact Spectrum directly if you would like assistance in selecting a platform to develop your next beamforming system. And with that, I would like to thank you for joining us, and we'll now open the line to questions.
Thank you, Cyrus and Tudor. We had a question about the archive of this webinar. We will be sending out a copy of the slides to you via email. As well, we will post a recording of this webinar on our website, www.spectrumsignal.com. And I remind you that if you have any questions, please feel free to enter it into the chat boxes or the Q&A boxes on the right panel. We have one question that asks, does your example system work in a harsh environment?
Yes, depending on what your system requirements are, the beamforming system can be deployed in more harsh environments. This also raises another benefit in doing the beamforming in software-defined radio. Your application can be ported to a much more rugged system. For example, Spectrum has a 3U OpenVPX line of boards and systems. System integrators can either develop directly on this platform or, for example, develop on the SDR2010 platform and port their code very easily to a 3U rugged line, OpenVPX line, as they share the same hardware architecture and software library.
Another question asks, your example implementation shows IF to Ethernet solution. What about RF to Ethernet?
Yes, Spectrum has also a range of RF solutions. Specifically, Spectrum's RF4902 is a dual-channel RF transceiver, which is a compact PCI RF transceiver that can be configured for multi-input or multi-output systems, which are typical of beamforming systems. It can cover 200 megahertz to 2.5 gigahertz with a receive bandwidth of up to 200 megahertz. It can also support phase coherent sampling. Spectrum also has announced a new XMC 3.2 gigasample per second dual input ADC card that is also capable of supporting direct conversion at RF and multiple input applications. We would be happy to discuss with folks their specific requirements to determine what's best for them when it comes to RF solutions.
Another question asks, do you also offer suitable RF front-end modules? So that's for transceive and receive.
Is that the same as the previous question?
Oh, sorry.
Oh, we have a question about
frequency. There was a question here about frequency.
What frequencies are your black box used in?
So the black box that we have shown in our example implementation, the SCR2010, is an IF to Ethernet subsystem. And so it our specific example that we have shown can work with third-party RF front-ends or even your RF front-end. The other option is Spectrum can suggest an RF front-end, and we also have a line of RF front-ends. One of them that which we just mentioned is the RF4902, which is a dual channel RF transceiver, which can support frequencies of between 200 megahertz to 2.5 gigahertz, and with received bandwidths up to 200 megahertz.
Are the Vertex 5 FPGAs only available in the FX series? There are some people who use mostly the FX series in the DSP.
Yes, the modules that we have shown are the Vertex 5 FX T FPGA. We also have other modules, including the R4902, which has an FX series part. I believe it's an FX 50 part, and it can be upgraded to larger devices as well.
A question, how to buffer the signal during SRDF and STIR? Delayed, not quite, delayed as being. Sorry, Igor, I'm having trouble reading some part of the question.
I believe the question is about buffering. One of the things that we didn't discuss was the potential use of a delay buffer. I believe that's what the question is about. A delay buffer lets you buffer the signal so you can actually look back in time if you're actually looking for a signal. So we didn't cover this, but having a delay buffer such as memory attached to the FPGA is something that those two modules do have. They have DDR2 memory attached to the FPGA, which can be used for a delay buffer. Hopefully that's the right question.
Any further questions? You can, again, just type into the chat box or the Q&A box on the right panel. Okay, I believe that wraps us up. I wanted to thank you all today for joining us. I do realize it's very early or very late in some of your time zones. A reminder that we will follow up with a copy of these slides to you. And if you have any further questions about anything you saw at the webinar or would like to know any about more of our products, you can always contact us. Tudor and Cyrus's email is available on the slide as well. You can contact sales@spectrumsignal.com. Thank you very much again, and we will be contacting you. Goodbye.